Okay, good afternoon, everybody. So here's a little bit of an overview of the things I'm going to cover today. We're going to talk about an integrative approach, which is what's really neat is that throughout the course of this morning, you're really getting a sense of how we operate here at Dana-Farber, which is a team approach, which is utilizing the different services here, whether we're talking about exercise or we're talking about nutrition, we're talking about your treatment, we're talking about social work and the more emotive and the more social components of your treatment. We're going to take that same approach when we look at nutrition today. We're going to talk about something that has been mentioned multiple times today, and you might be able to guess what it is before we actually launch into nutrition. It's a very close relative to nutrition. Our recommendations, what are they? How about supplements and herbs, particularly with oncology treatment? We have a lot of questions. Sometimes people come in with these really wicked long lists of supplements that they're on and ask, does this work with the treatment that I'm getting? Some common side effects of treatment, of course, if you've had a nutrition consult, you know that we have quite the repertoire of interventions and ways to support you through nutrition for your different side effects. And then one final really important piece of the pie, we'll make sure we talk about that. Okay, so an integrative approach to anything looks at multiple dimensions of the experience. So when we take an integrative approach to nutrition, it behooves me when I meet with you in a consult to make sure I'm not just coming in and talking about protein and fat and the vitamins and minerals and pancreatic enzymes or antidiarrheals. Those are important, and of course nobody's going to argue that. However, there's some really other important pieces that if I miss them, I'm not giving you the best care. So of course people want to know what kind of food should I eat, what should I avoid, the herbs and supplements. We discussed a little bit earlier about some of the inclusion of the complementary therapies that we have here. So Reiki, massage therapy, we have acupuncture here. Specifically, if you're experiencing dry mouth, for example, acupuncture might be one of the services, the complementary services that we offer here that could be helpful. Physical activity, which we're going to touch on in a moment, and then the mind-body connection and people's relationship with food. I can't overemphasize that last one enough, our relationship with food. So, how many of you have ever been stressed out and turned to food? Okay, when you're sad, maybe sometimes. Okay, when you're angry, how many of you angry eat? Ugh, it's the worst. Okay, so our relationship with food. Also, the foods that we grew up eating, the foods that are around us now, our culture, whether it were at work, when we're sick and people are bringing us food, food means so much more than what's on the plate. And so that's important to keep that in mind when I'm working with my patients. Okay, so like I said, before we're even going to dive into nutrition, I'm going to say it one more time. It's been said several times today, but that's how important this is, that it bears repeating one more time. There are so many studies that show a pretty serious link between people's physical activity or lack thereof and cancer. Specifically with colorectal cancers, there are over 50 studies looking at this association between physical activity and risk of colon cancer. 30 to 40% risk reduction, that's pretty significant when people are moving their bodies. It seems in terms of intensity, the intensity of your workout tends to have the greatest protective effect, but also duration and frequency have been researched, and the greater any of those, the better chance of risk reduction, or as we talked about before, the better you're able to go through treatment when you're moving your body. 30 to 60 minutes of moderate to vigorous physical activity seems to be kind of that sweet range in terms of physical activity. And so you might be saying, okay, that's great, but what do you mean by moderate to vigorous? Well, that would take another 10 minutes to explain. However, the link that's at the bottom of the slide, and you all have these handouts, so you can use that resource and go online at the CDC. They have a really nice description of a really big variety of different types of physical activity and what kind of counts for moderate and vigorous physical activity. So one of the other things that I often tell people is, if you're kind of, if physical activity is kind of a foreign thing, not everybody grew up with that being part of their lifestyle. And so if you're just getting into physical activity, one of the things I tell people is just find, this is my little saying, I say find the magic that moves you. In other words, find physical activity that kind of lights you up, that gets you excited, or when you're done with it, you feel really proud and enlivened that you just did that activity. If you are not a runner, and if the thought of running makes you want to go take a nap, then maybe running is not your physical activity of choice. But maybe Zumba is because you like to dance. Or maybe dancing is because you like to dance. So find the physical activity that works for you and try to incorporate that into your lifestyle on a regular basis. Yeah? That makes sense? So we actually, what's so great, again, because we talk about this over and over and over again, we support, we stand behind what we preach. And so we actually have free exercise consultations here. Nancy Campbell is our excellent exercise physiologist who can come and meet with you, do a consult with you. We have free exercise classes. If you are a patient here, you have a free gym membership. So again, to kind of touch base with Nancy, let her know what exactly that looks like. But if you need some support in terms of coming up with a regimen, if you decide I'd like to have some guidance getting started, or I need support to keep it going once I start, we have that resource here. It's free. Please utilize it. Okay, so we're going to start with the question that is usually really the most popular one that I'm asked when I meet with someone. Is there a recommended diet? And as you can see, there are a few common questions. So some of the most frequently asked questions are the ones that I'm going to address today. Sugar. So should I be avoiding sugar? I have my friend that told me that sugar feeds cancer, or I'm reading all these articles online that say sugar feeds cancer. What do you think? So here we go. We're going to dive into the sugar and cancer question. So our belief here in terms of the dietitian team at Dana-Farber is that it is not so much the sugar itself that is problematic. If we go back to what Dr. Fuchs was saying earlier today, it's more about how often you're having sugar in your diet and what is the load. So if I look back over the course of my day, I should be able to point out how many times I was having really sugar-concentrated foods, whether we're talking about sweets, whether we're talking about, you know, the Dunkin' Donut drinks that have the equivalent of a can and a half worth of soda of sugar in them. That's a really big load of sugar, and we don't support that as part of a healthy lifestyle. If you are someone that says, well, okay, what if I get a Dunkin' Donuts coffee and I put a teaspoon or I put a packet of sugar in it? I have less of a problem with that because it's not a large sugar load in your body in terms of releasing insulin, in terms of releasing insulin-like growth factor, which are things we aren't fans of, having surges of either of those throughout the course of the day. I'm okay with that because I don't see that eliciting that kind of response. So again, if we look at the Western diet, again, like was what was addressed earlier on, it tends to have a heavy sugar load. And so to start making small adjustments and finding ways where we can reduce our sugar consumption over the course of the day is a really good idea. But to completely avoid sugar sometimes for a lot of people will affect quality of life. Once they go to birthday parties and no longer eat a piece of cake, or they stop eating fruit because they're concerned about the sugar content in fruit. So we don't advocate those things. It is about moderation, and it's about finding a diet and a lifestyle that includes sugar to the extent that's comfortable for you, and then just knowing that we don't advocate really large doses of sugar. Organic versus inorganic. This is another really commonly asked question. So what I say for people to people is that the difference between organic and inorganic, there are obviously differences in terms of pesticide use between these two groups of fruits and veg. In terms of cancer occurrence and people that are eating all organic diets and reduced risk of cancer, we don't have research to support that right now. There is the Environmental Working Group is an organization that every year puts out, or they actually might do this biannually, they put out a list of most heavily pesticized fruits and vegetables. And you know what? I keep using that word pesticized. I'm not entirely sure that's a word. Do you guys, anybody know if I'm actually using a word or am I making that up? You okay with that? Okay, I got a nod. I'm okay. Pesticized. Pesticized is now a word. So they put out this list of the most heavily pesticized fruits and vegetables and the least. So the Dirty Dozen, they're referring to the most heavily pesticized fruits and vegetables for that period of time, maybe half year or year long period. And so if you're someone that says, I'm willing to put my money on organic foods, but I can't afford to do it for everything, they feel most comfortable spending the extra bucks on that category of highly pesticized fruits and vegetables. This group also put out the Clean 15, which is the least pesticized vegetables and fruits. So you can feel comfortable purchasing those because you know that the pesticide load on those foods are particularly low. So thicker skinned, you know, when we look at cantaloupes or watermelon, bananas, those tend to be the ones that are safer because they have that thick outer shell. So those usually are on the Clean 15 list. This ultimately is a little bit of a personal choice, what feels most comfortable to you. There are, of course, a lot of really strict diets that are out there that are promoted or claimed to be anti-cancer. And some of them are pretty restrictive. Some of them are really not sustainable. Some of them really impact your quality of life and your relationship with other people that are trying to eat in your household as well. So that's a common one. I'm eating this and people in my household are going crazy. So you really need to be asking yourself a few questions when you're considering doing a diet that might be alternative or that you feel might be supporting you through treatment. You need to ask those questions. Is this restrictive? Is this sustainable? Can I do this for more than a couple of months? And how is this going to affect my quality of life? Am I just going to be really low energy if I start removing these big categories of food from my diet? And then, of course, my personal bias is that you speak with a dietitian to make sure that you're not lacking any macro or micronutrients through this diet that you're choosing to trial. So make sure that someone else takes a peek at what you're doing, what you're eating, to make sure you're on point as you're going through treatment. So what are our dietary recommendations here at Dana-Farber? I think Michael Pollan's in his Food Rules book actually says it really well. And this also supports what our neighbor Walt Willett over at the Harvard School of Public Health also advocates. Eating food, eat mostly plants, and don't eat too much. So if we look at the first recommendation, eat food. So oftentimes what I recommend is I would recommend this for everybody to do this at least a few days, at least a couple weekdays, a couple weekend days, to keep a log, keep a track of what you're having to eat over the course of the day, and then go back and pull out this handout, pull out these slides, and see where you're doing really well, and see where you might be able to make some improvements. So, for example, if you take your recall, if you take your day's worth of food out, and we look at the slide, you can answer all three of these. Did I eat mostly food? Meaning, would you be able to tell me what you ate today, or was it a lot of packaged stuff? In which, if you're honest with yourself, you're not 100% sure what was in that box of, you know, or that frozen meal, or what was in that bar that you had, or that breakfast item. Or can you look back and say, that was an egg, that was a chicken breast, that was broccoli, that was a pear. I can tell you what those foods were in my day. So eating mostly food, can you recognize what you're eating? Mostly plants, so a heavily plant-based diet. Rich in phytonutrients and lots of nutrition. We're going to talk about that from an anti-cancer perspective. And then not too much. Of course, earlier I was just talking about the effects of consuming sugar, or if you consume excess foods, excess carbohydrate, can also elicit the insulin. The insulin-like growth factor response can be pro-inflammatory to overconsume foods. It's just a lot of work on our body. If you think of our body always trying to keep homeostasis, when we throw a large amount of anything in our body at one time, the body has to work a little bit harder to get back down to that nice happy place. So thinking about eating to the point where you're comfortable, where you're satisfied, but not eating too much. Okay, so particularly for our oncology patients, we talk about a colorful plant-based diet, meaning the color, the crucifers, the flavonoids that come from the different colors from different fruits and vegetables. These are the way that the plant shows off its immune system. So by consuming a variety of colors over the course of your day, or if you're just starting out to include more fruits and vegetables, thinking about more variety over the course of a week, the more anti-cancer properties we get. All of these phytonutrients, all of these colors of the plants do different things in terms of anti-cancer. They might promote apoptosis or programmed cell death of cancer cells. They might actually initiate reduced blood flow to tumor cells. So different colors are doing different things. There's a synergy in these whole foods. So with these phytonutrients and the other components of the food, there's a synergy that we have not figured out, which is why we talk about eating foods, because as much as we try to extract this good-looking stuff, the phytonutrients, and put them in pill form, it just doesn't work as well as when you eat the whole food. So lots of colorful plant-based foods. And then also healthful fats and lean proteins. These are important. Again, we talk about healthful fats, we talk about anti-inflammation. So the monounsaturated fats, whether it's avocado, olive oil, again, the lunch today was fantastic in promoting omega-3 fatty acids. We had salmon out there. We had olive oil on the pasta. So incorporating healthy fats and lean proteins. We had the fish out there. We had the chicken out there. We had tofu, great sources of protein. These particular two foods are also important depending on if you're experiencing certain side effects of treatment. So if you're noticing loss of appetite, if you're noticing nausea, and therefore your intake is significantly reduced, these particular macronutrients, if we talk about healthy fat, in small portions, they're going to provide a lot of nutrition. So if you're eating really small portion sizes, it makes sense if we're trying to maintain our weight and we're trying to maintain our nutrition to have healthy fats throughout the course of the day in our little mini meals. So thinking about peanut butter, almonds, trail mixes, putting olive oil in your soup, if right now soup is the only thing that's really feeling okay, that's one way that you can fortify your meals, but keep your portion sizes small. And then, of course, in terms of lean protein, we're looking at repairing cells, that maybe there was some healthy tissue that was got in the way of the radiation, or some of the healthy tissue that is damaged because of the chemotherapy, which we know is which happens with a lot of our cells that turn over very quickly. So we need to repair those tissues, and lean protein is one of the macronutrients that will do that. All right, in terms of limiting certain foods, particularly when we're talking about GI cancers, we want to reduce our red meat consumption and our processed meat consumption. There's pretty ample research to show that red meat and processed meats are associated with incidence of certain GI cancers. The mechanism, we're still trying to figure that out, and we have some different working theories right now. But what we do know from cumulative evidence is that red meat and processed meats, we try to discourage their intake on a regular basis. And then foods to limit nutrient-poor foods. So for two reasons. Number one, because these foods, again, when we consume them, tend to not fill us up, so we tend to eat more of them. If you've ever had one cup of a sugary cereal with milk, dollars to donuts, that's a funny... Okay, well, my guess is that you probably found yourself hungry, you know, a half hour later, an hour later. They're not filling, so what we end up doing is consuming more of them. We don't fill up, and so your load of these nutrient-poor foods tends to be greater. The second problem with these foods are that they replace our opportunity to get in the anti-cancer, the phytonutrient-rich foods. So if you're full on any of these, you're less likely to have an apple, you're less likely to have, you know, peanut butter, you're less likely to have eggs in the morning if you're filling up. So they take up a space where we could have had an opportunity to get some nutrition in. Supplements. We earlier heard about vitamin D, and just actually this past week we had research published with some of the senior co-authors right here from Dana-Farber in terms of vitamin D and seeing that it's helpful in terms of activating the immune system, we believe, to protect against cancer. Omega-3 fatty acids for that anti-inflammatory effect. And these are appropriate, I'd say, for most people, but again, that's the benefit, I think, of meeting with a dietitian, because we can see if this is something you would actually benefit from. If you're getting fatty fish in a couple of times a week, you might not necessarily need this, or if you're getting walnuts or ground flaxseed, other sources of omega-3 fatty acids in portion sizes that make this unnecessary. And then probiotics, also with a lot of GI cancers, we see side effects in terms of constipation, diarrhea, and probiotics oftentimes are indicated for these patients. Herbs and plants, curcumin and green tea. When we look at some of the anti-tumor properties of both of these, they look really encouraging and promising. There is some caution, and again, that's with all of the supplements and the herbs and the plants. Before you embark on any of these and utilizing these and incorporating any of these as part of your treatment plan, first of all, you should definitely let your care team know that you're using these, because depending on your chemotherapy or your treatment, there can be interactions, as there are, for example, with high doses of your curcumin. So my recommendation is make sure that you run this by your team, number one. And number two, curcumin, I think, is best in whole food cooking form. So incorporating it with pepper, incorporating it with healthy fats makes it more bioavailable. So consider adding it in your cooking, perhaps, versus the pill form, the capsule form. We don't necessarily recommend that for a lot of these herbs and things that you can get in whole food form. Same with green tea. Doing cups of that versus doing your green tea capsules and pills is what we recommend, particularly in terms of interacting with chemo. Managing side effects. So some of these I'm going to spend less time on because they are in your packet and you can, they're pretty straightforward, and I just want to make sure we have time for question and answer. But some of the ones I think, again, are a little bit more intimately related with GI cancers are the diarrhea and constipation. This is something that I feel like the majority of my patients are struggling with in one direction or the other. And so this Banitrol is something I just recently, and I'm not getting any support from any of the products that I'm talking about today. Banitrol Plus is essentially banana flakes with a prebiotic. And this can be helpful for people that are concerned about swinging over into constipation with some of the medications that they take for when they have diarrhea. And so this is just something a little bit more gentle to help you regulate your bowels. Fluid is so important whether we're talking about diarrhea or constipation. Okay, and then for constipation, also no kickback from Smooth Move, but this is something that I find is helpful for people if they're doing their colace and they're doing the Miralax and they're still not able to regulate their bowels. This is a form of Senna. It's in its herbal form. As opposed to its capsule form, it's in its herbal form and in tea form. And sometimes this is really effective for people, even when they're taking the Senna pills and they're still not having a bowel movement. So this can be really good. And then here you see the incorporation of some of the other integrative therapies that we have here. Moving your body, getting massage, yoga can help stimulate the GI system. Taste changes, I'm not going to speak too much about those. You can certainly refer to your handout. Nausea, I think this is important to touch on, that strong smells and the cooking in and of itself can really turn people off. So if you're the person in your family that does most of the cooking, we need to come up with another game plan. Because in terms of having the smells wafting up while you're preparing it, Sometimes that's enough to stop, you know, stop you before you even get a chance to try some of your cooking. So allowing the foods to actually be cooked and then cool off in another room before they're presented to you so that they have time to cool, there isn't that wafting of the aroma, which can turn you off. So let your foods kind of prepare and cool off in another room if you have the opportunity to do that. Ginger is a really big one. Sucking on fresh ginger or ginger chews. There's actually research to support that is helpful in terms of nausea. And then this is interesting. I feel like a lot of people, whether we're talking about the reflux or we're talking about nausea, they tend to eat something and then they go and recline and then they don't understand why they're feeling nauseous. But you really need to stay upright, particularly if you're having any kind of anti-motility issues, if your food tends to sit a little bit longer, which can happen during treatment. It's important to stay as upright as possible versus kind of getting relaxed and reclining. That can also be an initiator of nausea and reflux. Loss of appetite. Two of them that I want to point out is cleaning your mouth before you eat. People often say, because of my treatment, you know, I'm really careful with my oral hygiene and I rinse my mouth afterwards, and I say that's great. But there can, because chemo is systemic, we have to remember that it's in our saliva as well. And so actually rinsing out your mouth before you eat can better help the taste come through in certain foods, but it can also make them taste less strange so that you're not as turned off when you're eating your foods. They might taste a little bit more like they're supposed to if you get rid of that film in your mouth. Small, more frequent meals. It seems so counterintuitive that if we have a loved one that's not eating, that we present them a really small plate of food because we're concerned about them and they're not eating. And so usually people that are really well-intentioned will bring this really large, beautiful plate of food, and it's a turnoff. So keeping portion sizes small, we're more likely to eat all of it and actually have that mini meal and get some nutrition in versus not wanting to go there. And then the last one, relax and have your loved ones relax too. One of my jobs as a dietitian when I'm working with people is to help people and their loved ones relax, because eating, like we said, it's more about the food, right? It's how we love each other. It's how we take care of each other during treatment. So if someone's not eating this meal that I just prepared for them and put all this love into, it creates tension. It creates anxiety. Sometimes I walk into a room and you can cut the tension with a knife. You know, they were waiting for me to come to be kind of, you know, say who's right and who's wrong in the relationship in terms of eating. So we just need to kind of take a breath and relax and know we'll do the best we can at this mini meal time. And when the next time comes, we'll give it a try again. But the stress doesn't help the appetite. So we need to just kind of relax and then point to me. Make me do the hard work to troubleshoot and figure out how we're going to get the food and the nourishment in. Okay, so we just talked about that. If they're mini, they need to be nutrient dense, or ideally they're nutrient dense. So if we have crackers, and crackers are really the only thing that's feeling good right now or sounding good, what if we put a little bit of peanut butter on them? Because in small doses, peanut butter has a lot of calories. All right, finally, one last thing is that we can't get lost in the food itself. And this is an awesome quote from Mark David. In short, we've removed nourishment from nutrition. In our valiant efforts to create a science of eating, we've lost a bit of soul. So again, remembering to relax, think of food as that heart and the soul, and to, you know, think of communion with your family still with nutrition, and let's not lose that when we get caught up in the supplements and the nuts and bolts of nutrition.